before and after? First of all, it's a change.
Before and after, I'm not really sure.
It was kind of like the do you know or something like that, or do you agree?
Yeah. Yep. Totally.
I didn't really know what before and after was. I thought it was like a quote that someone got from a movie, and it was just really inspirational.
But then I kept walking, I saw it everywhere, so I didn't really know what was going on.
Cool. Yeah, it caught my attention, but I had no idea what it meant.
I thought it had some sort of deeper meaning, but
I thought it was like someone before and after, like athletic wise, you know, like weight loss, you think before and after.
A change that EIU needs.
Hey everyone, you're probably wondering what the whole before and after thing is that's going on here on campus with the chalk and the t-shirts. Well, it's these two words that describe us. The first word describes us, what we were like before we knew Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And the second word is the after, which describes us now that we know Jesus.
I need you to know this, and in your heart I need you to today, by faith, believe this, that whoever you are and whatever you've done or however dirty and disgusting and defiled your life has been, you reach out to Jesus in faith, and you don't make him unclean, he makes you clean.
It doesn't matter what you've done.
Before I knew Jesus as the Lord of my life, I just kind of lived life as I do things because I have to do that to survive. You know, I eat, I drink, hang out with friends, do work hard at school, things were just so, and I was very aimless.
I don't need help. Least of all, I don't need God's help. If someone had said, do you want me to pray for anything, or have you tried taking your problem to God, I would have been like, God's for those big things.
Before I really, like, truly accepted Christ, I was enslaved to fun. I was living my life trying to get satisfaction out of people, and just having fun, and that led into certain people. And so I was just like trying to fulfill myself with having fun and getting life experiences and stuff like that, but it wasn't working.
When I lose my way and I forget my name, remind me who I am. In the mirror all I see is who
I was heavily involved in athletics, wanting to do my best in school, wanting friends and people to like me and relationships, and that's really where my identity lied. If those things weren't going well, if sports, school, relationships, I was unhappy. That's where my identity was. So when they weren't well, I wasn't happy with who I was or how things were going.
But I obsessed over my problems, and I was just very discontent because I could never get control. And I thought if I had control that I would be happy, but I could never quite get it.
I've noticed myself not having the trust that I need in certain aspects of my life.
I was a prideful guy. I wanted to be like everybody else, to be the cool kid.
I felt unworthy of forgiveness, and I felt like there was nothing I could do to change that.
Before I came to Christ, I was doing a lot of things I knew was wrong, but I just kind of kept on going with it.
I was completely independent growing up. I, just how I was raised within my family, I just controlled everything.
I continued gaining a knowledge of who God was from outside sources, but I was always kind of apathetic to actually pursue and devote my life to Christ.
Who I am to you, who I am.
Basically a slave to a bunch of different things, whether that just be the expectations of parents, relatives, friends, trying to be the best at the sports I played. My joy was dependent on whether all those things were going well or not.
And on many mission trips that I would come home and I'd be so on fire and I wouldn't know what to do with this new fire that I had, and I was very timid and very scared of myself and who I was, and so I just let the fire die after a few weeks.
I felt this pressure from my parents, from my friends, from my teachers, and just that I had to be this awesome person and I couldn't screw up ever or I was going to make God angry. And I quickly learned that I can't be perfect, I couldn't be good, and every time I screwed up I just felt incredibly guilty and ashamed of what I had done.
I grew up in a church,
and I grew up in a Christian home, and really it was just expected of us to go to church and everything. And honestly, I didn't get the point.
That God in eternity looked upon me, foreseeing my fallenness, my pride, my sin, and said, I want that man in my family. I'll do anything to get him in my family. I will pay for him to be in my family with my son's life. That's love, folks. That is mega, off the charts love.
When I was a sophomore in high school, I got into this car crash, and I looked and a car was coming, you know. I don't remember, the car like flipped and rolled, but everything just went black. And when I woke up, I realized I could have died, and I don't know my maker.
Coming to Christ and learning more about who God was and his character, the word that described my life would be resting. God created me and he loves me, and he has a plan for my life, and my identity now lies in him, in Christ and what he did for me.
Now I eat and I drink for the glory of God. I pray that my marriage reflects, you know, Christ in the church. Everything that I do has this purpose of glorifying God.
After Christ, I feel free. I feel, I still do those things, but it's because I want to, and I'm free to do them, and it's because I, out of my love for Christ. And so, I don't have to do those things to earn my salvation. Jesus is how I have my salvation, and he is the ultimate, like, price, and that's like a gift.
Even though I still struggle with, you know, the high expectations I have for myself that, you know, I should be Superwoman, I don't need help, but I realize that, like, I do.
I don't take pride in myself, but I take pride in Christ. And that is the transformation in my maturity as a Christian.
Of my sophomore year, I accepted Christ. He's been changing me to be more like him. Instead of pursuing these things that constantly never satisfy me, he satisfies me.
Because God doesn't make a to-do list for you, thankfully. He gives you this free gift of grace, and because of that, I don't have to work to get to him. It's not about what I do, it's about what's already done.
God has us where he wants us, whether or not it's the way you thought it should have, we should have gotten there. He can use you no matter where you are, and so that's what I'm trying to do. You know, you gotta live in the moment, and no matter where you're placed, you know, there's always good that can come from it.
I'm a Christian, and I'm there to follow Christ and obey his word. And by diving into his word, I'm able to know exactly what he wants for me in my life.
God is always holding on to us, and he constantly is seeking after us and seeking a relationship with us. And so at that moment, I just let everything go, and I realized that there's nothing I could do to earn it. And while I mess up constantly, he never lets go of me, and he shows me unfailing grace and mercy constantly.
God's ways and thoughts are higher than my ways and thoughts. Reading through scripture, and I saw Isaiah 55, it basically says that God knows best. It's like he's the only one who can pull, like, because I'm dad, like, that's enough for him to say that and for you to just trust it. But Isaiah 55 says that his ways and thoughts are higher than my ways and thoughts. And that's just straight truth.
God has given me a purpose in life that if all else fails in my life, the one thing that I pray to succeed in is representing him well and just living my life that is pleasing to him.
After finally accepting the fact that Christ had died for my sins and there was nothing that I could do to please God, but that he's pleased with me because of Jesus, I just felt free.
I feel more comfortable knowing what it means to be a Christian and how to live my life, and that gives me much strength. And so with Christ's death and with his salvation, I feel strengthened with the hope that he gives me, and knowing that my eternal destination is secure.
In Hebrews, and it's Hebrews 6:19, and it says, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. That, I think of that every day, just hope. It's such a strong feeling, and I am so hopeful now.
You know, and then now it's like a relationship, and before I didn't know that Jesus was walking with me every day in my life, and that's how it is now, and it's awesome.
You hear that Jesus came and died for your sins, but why? I mean, even people who go to church their whole lives never hear that, but the whole point is because he loves you and wants to reestablish that relationship. He cares about you that much. He wants to make you a completely new person. For some of you, that doesn't sound like anything you want, because you like who you are. You think you're content with where you are. You have enough Jesus to the point where he'll fix your little problems you may have. And he's not really going to interfere in your life. But I promise you, when he interferes in your life and when he completely takes over, is when you become this beautiful new person, this beautiful new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, whoever is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. And that's what this is all about. Is Jesus is in the business of raising people from the dead, like it says in Ephesians. He is in the business of transforming lives. And he would love just to come in and to make you a completely new creation and make you alive in him and to call you a child of God.
He were my shield and push me as long as life